Zimmer.
Guppy.
Not The openings in most of the through tracks, ripped up along the others. They'll be totally overgrown by now. Okay. So which tracks are closed? Webster asked. He had turned the plan and was studying it. We don't know, the guy said. We didn't keep very accurate records. Just sent the bulldozers out. We caught a lot of guys close to the wrong tracks because they were nearer, or not closing them at all, because that was easier. The whole thing was a mess. So is there any way through? Johnson asked. The forest guy shrugged. Maybe, he said. Maybe not. No way of knowing except to try it. Could take a couple of months. If you do get through, keep a record and let us know, okay?
He yawned, checked his watch, gestured to Milosevic and Brogan.
We should get a sleeping rota going, he said. You two turn in first. We'll sleep two shifts, call it 4 hours at a time. Milosevic and Brogan nodded, looked happy enough about it. See you later, McGraw said. Sleep tight. They left the trailer and closed the door quietly. Johnson was still fiddling with the map, twisting it and turning it on the table. Can't they do the phone thing faster? He asked, like tonight. Webster thought about it and nodded. He knew 50% of any battle is keeping the command structure harmonious. Call him again, Mac, he said. Tell them we need it now. McGraw called him again. He used the phone at his elbow. Had a short conversation, which ended with a chuckle. Sending the emergency line man, he said. Should be done in a couple of hours, but we'll get an invoice for it. I told them to send it to the Hoover building. The guy asked me where that was. He got up and waited in the doorway. Johnson and Webster stayed at the table. They huddled together over their map. They looked at the southern ravine. It had been formed a million years ago when the earth shattered under the weight of a billion tons of ice. They assumed it was accurately represented on paper. Chapter 36. Reacher woke up exactly 2 minutes before 10 o'clock. He did it in his normal way, which was to come round quickly, motionless, no change in his breathing. He felt his arm curled under his head and opened his eyes the smallest fraction possible. The other side of the punishment hut, Joseph Ray was still sitting against the door. The block was on the floor beside him. He was checking his watch. Reacher counted off 90 seconds in his head. Ray was glancing between the roof of the hut and his watch. Then he looked across at Reacher. Reacher snapped upright in one fluid movement, pressed his palm against his ear like he was listening to a secret communication. Ray's eyes were wide. Reacher nodded and stood up. Okay, he said. Open the door, Joe. Ray took out the key from his pocket,
He wasn't worried about the dogs. They were out. Fowler had talked about mountain lions roaming. Nobody leaves dogs out at night where there are mountain lions on the prowl. That's a sure way of having no dogs left in the morning. He made a complete circuit of the bastion, hidden in the trees. The lights were all out and the whole place was still and silent. He waited in the trees behind the mess hall. The kitchen was a square hut, awkwardly connected to the back of the main structure. There were no lights on, but the door was open, and the woman who had served him breakfast was waiting in the shadows. He watched her from the trees. He waited 5 minutes, then six. No other movement anywhere. He tossed his small rock onto the path to her left. She jumped at the sound. He called softly. She came out of the shadows. Alone. She walked over to the trees. He took her elbow and pulled her back into the darkness.
How did you get out of there?
She whispered to him. It was impossible to tell how old she was. Maybe 25, maybe 45. She was a handsome woman, lean, long straight hair, but careworn and worried. A flicker of spirit and resilience underneath. She would have been comfortable 100 years ago, stumbling down the Oregon Trail.
How did you get out?
She whispered again. I walked out of the door. The woman just looked at him blankly.
You've got to help us,
she whispered. Then she stopped and wrung her hands and twisted her head left and right, peering into the dark, terrified. Help out, he asked. Why?
They're all crazy,
the woman said.
You've got to help us.
How? He asked again. She just grimaced, arms held wide, like it was obvious, or like she didn't know where to start, or how. From the beginning, he said. She nodded twice, swallowing, collecting herself.
People have disappeared,
she said. What thing? He asked. How did they disappear?
They just disappeared,
she said.
It's Morgan. He's taken over everything. It's a long story. Most of us were up here with other groups, just surviving on our own with our families, you know? I was with the Northwestern Freemen. Then Orkin started coming around talking about unity. He fought and argued. And the other leaders disagreed with his views. Then they just started disappearing. They just left. Orkin said they couldn't stand the pace. They just disappeared. So he said we had to join with him. He said we had no choice. Some of us are more or less prisoners here.
Reacher nodded. She said. What things? He asked her.
I don't know,
she said.
Bad things, I guess. We're not allowed to go up there. They're only a mile up the road, but they're off limits. Something's going on there today. They said they were all working on the south, on the border. But when they came back to the they came from the north. I saw them from the kitchen window. They were smiling and laughing.
Who? Reacher asked.
Morgan and the ones he trusts,
she said.
He's crazy. He says they'll attack us when we declare independence. We have to fight back. Start tomorrow. We're all scared. We got families, you know. But there's
until he was well north of the parade ground. Then he tracked east until he saw the road running up out of York. It was potholed and rough, gleaming gray in the moonlight. He stayed in the shadow of the trees and followed it north. The road wound up the mountainside in tight hairpin bends. The sure sign had led to something worthwhile. Otherwise, the labor consumed in its construction would have been meaningless. After a mile of winding and 1,000 feet of elevation, the final curve gave out onto a bowl the size of a deserted stadium. It was part natural, part blasted, hanging there in the belly of the giant peaks. The back walls of the bowl were sheer rock faces. There were semicircular holes blasted into them at intervals. They looked like giant mouse holes. Some of them had been built out with waste rock to provide sheltered entrances. Two of the entrances had been enlarged into giant stone sheds roofed with timber. The bowl was floored with loose shale. There were piles of earth and spoil everywhere. Ragged weeds and saplings were forcing their way through. Reacher could see the rusted remains of rail tracks, starting nowhere and running a few yards. He squatted against a tree well back in the woods and watched. There was nothing happening. The whole place was deserted and silent, quieter than silent. It had that total absence of sound that gets left behind when a busy place is abandoned. The natural sounds were long gone. The swaying trees cleared, the rushing streams diverted, the rustling vegetation burned off, replaced by clattering machines and shouting men. Then when the men and the machines leave, there's nothing left behind to replace their noise. Reacher strained his ears, but heard nothing at all. Silent as the moon. He stayed in the woods. To approach from the south meant to approach uphill. He skirted around to the west and gained an extra 100 feet of height. Paused and looked down into the bowl from a new perspective. Still nothing. But there had been something. Some recent activity. The moonlight was showing vehicle tracks in the shale. There was a mess of ruts in and out of one of the stone sheds. A couple of years' worth. The motor pool. There were newer ruts into the other stone shed. The bigger shed. Bigger ruts. Somebody had driven some large vehicles into that shed. Recently. He scrambled reflected off the rock. There were a dozen vehicles parked in neat lines, old sedans and pickups, surplus jeeps with crude camouflage, and the white Ford Econoline with the holes in the roof. It looked sad and abandoned after its epic journey from Chicago, worn out and low on its springs. There were workbenches with old tools hanging above them, cans of paint and drums of oil, bald tires and piles, and rusted tanks of welding gas. He searched the nearest vehicles, keys in all of them, a flashlight in the glove box of the third sedan he checked. He took it, stepped back to the pickup and killed its headlights, walked back to the big wooden doors and out into the night. He waited and listened. Nothing. He swung the motor pool door closed and set off for the larger shed, 100 yards across the noisy shale. The larger shed had the same type of log doors, even bigger. And they were locked. The lock was the crudest thing he had ever seen. It was an old warped log laid across two iron brackets and chained into place. The chains were fastened with two big padlocks. Reacher ignored them. No need to fiddle with the padlocks. He could see that the warp in the old log would let him in. He forced the doors apart where they met at the bottom. The curve in the log and the brackets let them gap by about a foot. He put his arms inside, then his head, then his shoulders. He scrambled with his feet and pushed his way through, stood up inside, and flicked the flashlight on. It was another giant cavern. Same darkness, same strong smell of damp and decay, same sloping roof running backward to a low ceiling. The same hush, like all the sound was sucking back deep into the mountain. The same purpose, a vehicle store. But these vehicles were all identical. Five of them. Five current issue U.S. Army trucks, marked with the white stencils of the Army Air Artillery. Not new trucks, but well maintained. Neat canvas siding at the rear. Reacher walked around to the back of the first truck, stepped up onto the tow hitch, and looked over the tailgate. Empty. It had slatted wooden benches running forward along each side. A troop carrier. Reacher couldn't begin to count the miles he'd traveled on benches like those, swaying, staring at the steel floor, waiting to get where he was going. The steel floor was stained, at odds with the clean exterior. There were black stains on the floor, some kind of a thick liquid, for a man to stay in. 20 dead soldiers. A hell of a mess.
Mm.
They had all been shot in the back. Reacher could see that. They had been standing together in a group somewhere, and they had been mown down and gunfire from the rear. He bent and grunted and turned a couple of them over. Not the toughest guys he'd ever seen. Docile reservist types, deployed to a lonely base deep inside friendly territory. Ambushed and murdered for their weapons. But how? He knew how. An old ground-to-air unit, nearing obsolescence, stationed in the far north of Montana. A leftover from Cold War paranoia, certainly due for decommissioning. Probably already in the process of decommissioning. Probably on its way south to Peterson in Colorado. Final orders, probably transmitted in clear by radio. You remember the radio scanner back in the communications hut? The operator beside it, patiently turning the dial. He imagined the recall order being accidentally intercepted, the operator running to Borkum, Borkum's bloated face lighting up with an opportunistic smile. Then some hasty planning and a brutal ambush somewhere in the hills. 20 men shot down, thrown into their own truck, piled into this cavern. He stood and gazed at the appalling sight. Then he snapped the flashlight off again. Because he had been right about the noise. It was the noise of footsteps on the shale outside. He heard them again. They were getting closer. They were building to a deafening, crunching sound in the night. They were heading straight for the shed. On the shale, no way of telling how many people there were. He heard them stop outside the massive doors, heard the jingle of keys, heard the padlocks rattle. The chains were pulled off and the log lifted aside. The doors sagged open. He dropped to the ground, lay face down, and pressed himself up against the pile of cold and oozing bodies. 4 feet, two voices. Voices he knew well, Fowler and Borkum. Talking quietly, walking confidently. Reacher let his body sag against the pile. A rat ran over his hand. Did he say when? Fowler was asking. His voice was suddenly loud against the rock.
First thing tomorrow morning,
Borkum was saying.
Phone company starts its linemen when? About 8 o'clock, maybe 7:30?
Let's be cautious, Fowler said. Let's call it 7:30. First thing they do is cut the line. They had flashlights. The beams flicked and swung as they walked.
No problem,
Borkum said.
7 o'clock here is 9 o'clock on the East Coast. Perfect timing. We'll do it at 7. D.C. first, then New York, then Atlanta. Should be all done by 10 past. 10 minutes that shook the world, right?
Mm.
20 minutes to spare.
They stopped at the second truck, unbolted the tailboard. It came down with a loud metallic clang.
Then what?
Fowler asked.
Then we wait and see,
Borkum replied.
Right now, they've only got 8 Marines up here. They don't know what to do. They're not sure about the forest. White House is pussyfooting like we thought. Give them 12 hours for a decision. They can't try anything before dark tomorrow earliest. But by then, this place will be way down their list of priorities.
They were leaning into the truck. Their voices were muffled. Does he need the missile as well? Fowler asked.
Just the launcher,
Borkum answered.
It's in the electronic part.
Reacher lay among the scuffling rats and heard the sound of the clips being undone. Then the squeak of the rubber as a launcher came out of its mountings. Then the rattle of the tailgate bolts ramming home. The footsteps receded. The flashlight beams flicked back toward the doors. The hinges creaked and the bulky timber doors thumped shut. Reacher heard the launcher being laid gently on the shale and the gasps as the two men lifted the old log back into the brackets. The rattle of the chain and the click of the padlocks. The crunch of the footsteps crossing the shale. He rolled away from the corpses and hit out at a rat, caught it with an angry backhand and sent it squealing off into the dark. He sat up and waited, walked slowly to the door, listened.
they wouldn't move more than an inch. He laid his palms flat on the smooth timbers and bunched up his shoulders and moved. They were rock solid, like trying to push over a tree. He tried for a minute,